coming to you from the city where slippers are not to be worn after 10 p.m. Sorry, Hector. It's Ventriloquism Weekly. Mondays mean I get to spend time with you, and I'm Matt Bailey. Today, Sylvia Fletcher joins us to talk about how she went from being a stay-at-home mom to doing over 400 shows a year. You all know Sylvia as one of the hardest-working fair performers out there. She even has her own stage that she brings with her, people. Her own stage. To talk about how being in total control of her performances allows her to create something truly original and memorable for her audiences. Here now, our interview with Sylvia Fletcher. Sylvia Fletcher, welcome to Ventriloquism Weekly. How are you doing today?
Good. How are you, Matt?
I am great. I'm so excited to have you. This is going to be a lot of fun. Author, ventriloquist, of course, author, children's book author. I mean, you do it all. I think it's great. But we want to begin at the beginning. How did you get started in ventriloquism?
Well, I fell in love with Paul Winchell when I was a little girl. And I just, I'd watch what he did, what he did, and then I would find out about Mayer's Studios. And I just... it was just one of those things that I fell in love with. I wanted to learn more, and I've just been following it.
That's wonderful.
But it started when I was about six.
Really? That's great. Paul Winchell, one of the masters, just brilliant.
Oh, I loved Paul Winchell. Oh, my gosh, he was so awesome.
Yes.
The manipulation of the character itself were fabulous. So I fell in love with him first.
That's fantastic. Now, where did you start performing, and when did you start performing? How soon afterwards?
Oh, gosh. Well, what happened is, you know, I fell in love with watching Paul Winchell and ventriloquists on television. And then I saw a Willie Talk dummy, a little dummy doll, and I asked for it for Christmas. And I was about, I don't know, I was probably about six or seven. Mm-hmm. And I put something together, showed my dad. My dad thought it was really cute. So my dad used to have me, anytime people would come over, my dad would go, okay, pull out your dummy and do something. And it was like, no, Dad, I don't want to pull out my dummy. He's like, yes, you've got to pull out your dummy. So I was like Dad's, you know, dog and pony show.
That's great.
And then Dad started putting me into talent shows. And, you know, it was Dad. You know, I loved doing it. I was really shy, and it was hard at first. So when he'd go, pull out the dummy, it was like, no, I'm not pulling out the dummy. And then once I'd get there on stage, it would just start taking off. So it's a kind of a comical thing, and I did it all through high school, and it was not all the time. It was just, you know, high school, I wanted to win the freshman president, so I'm like, hey, how could I do that? How could I do it so that I could win, you know, because you have to be memorable.
Yeah.
Right? So being memorable is really important, so I'm like, okay, I know how I'll do it. I'll use... then it was Leon. It was another. That was like probably my fifth, you know, doll dummy that I had gotten. And he was my campaign manager.
I love it.
So, and you know, I had put posters all over that said, "Don't be a dummy. Vote for Sylvia." You know, but they didn't know who he was. They didn't know I was going to bring up an actual event figure, and until it actually. The day of the day I had to try out in front of the school, and then they thought, okay, dummy, don't be a dummy, he's a dummy. You know?
I love it.
So, what was I? Probably 14. So, you know, it's always been something that has been a hobby for me.
That's great. Yeah, that really rings a bell. You know, I went to a performing arts high school myself, and so where it was really sort of the unique thing to be able to do in high school. So that just, I love to hear that, because at least I know I'm not the only one running around with the puppet.
I grew up in Southern California,
oh, cool.
So it was kind of like, you know, home of, you know, theater,
yeah.
You know, doing stuff like that. It was... you know, it was so cool. Kids thought it was so funny and so cool. So
that's awesome. Now,
yeah.
Those shows, now that's, you know, performing in school and pulling it out where creatively. When did you decide, okay, I'm going to really pursue this?
So I've always wanted, when I was a little girl, I always wanted I always thought someday I would be a performer. I loved acting and I loved theater and I loved ventriloquism. And I didn't know if it was going to be that way as a ventriloquist, but it just happened, it kept on coming up.
Mm-hmm.
But when I got out of high school, it was like, okay, now, you know, you really have to get a big girl's job. You can't really... you know, be a ventriloquist, you know, that's, so I got into marketing and a lot of other things. My parents had businesses, which I ran, and I didn't do anything with it. Then I got married, and I had children, two boys,
mm-hmm.
and I was a stay-at-home mom. And when... I would go to these parties with them as little kids and see these acts. And I was like, oh my gosh, I would love to be able to have, I didn't need to work, you know, but I was like, oh, wouldn't that be cool? I'll just get like some mad money so I can like go to Macy's.
Yeah.
Go shopping. So I put together a show and it kind of just snowballed and took off.
That's really cool.
For 20 years now, I've been doing it professionally.
That's incredible. it's just put your mind to it. What would you say to those who are in the position where you were, that maybe they stay at home or maybe their job is not necessarily the career they want to have? What would you say, putting your mind to it, what kind of advice would you give to those people that are maybe on the fence about doing it?
You know what? I think... you just have to put your mind to it and not give up. It's, you know, the hardest thing for me was when I was first starting, you know, you have your script, you have your basic bone script,
mm-hmm.
Skeleton of a script, and it's not polished. And it's going to take you years to polish. And so when you first start out, you know, you might have, if you want it to be a funny act, it may not be, you might get, let's just say, maybe in 45 minutes, let's say you get, when you first start, you might get 10 laps. But then as you keep on doing it, you start building up laughs. In the areas people weren't laughing, now they are, because you've polished it and you've gotten the timing down. So it's a matter of just going out there.
Mm-hmm.
And falling down and coming back up and learning from where, you know, where they didn't laugh. Okay, now what am I going to do different? And in 20 years, you know, it's like, it's not the same script. It changes. Now it's a work in progress and I know how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to just keep polishing.
Incredible.
And it's not easy. I mean, you might come home and you're like, oh my gosh, the audience, you know, or what was wrong with me today, when it might have been the same thing that you've done before, but that's just the way performing is and live performing is. So I say don't give up. Just, you know, just keep on trudging away.
Yeah, you said a word that we don't often hear, or that we often hear, but I think a lot of us, I know for me, I'm just starting to figure out exactly what it means, which is polishing. Because you hear polish and you think, what? Like, get up and do it. How does it get better through just doing the same thing over and over again? So can you define what polishing your act means to you?
Oh, my gosh. Polishing is where you have an idea that you think is going to be fun. Okay, here's something polishing. Mm-hmm. One thing that I always wanted to do was I like to do things in the show that are now. Mm-hmm. And that are today. I don't like to do the old script from the old long ago ventriloquist. I like to come up with original stuff. So because today the cell phone is so much into our lives, I wanted the character to bug me on stage, Sylvia, the character, me as the ventriloquist, with the phone. So I put him away, and all of a sudden my phone rings in the show. Well, it's kind of like apropos because, I mean, isn't that what happens now?
Yeah.
People forget to turn their cell phones off, but they don't realize it's going to come from me. Well, it took me a year to even try it out just because it was kind of different. And, of course, I have no puppet in my hand. I'm just picking up the phone and going, hello, what do you want? And so the polish of how that phone conversation is going to go and what's going to make it funny, because now you don't have a puppet out there. You
Right.
have you and a phone. So polishing, okay, Smolder, so what do you want? Well, I want to talk to Joe. So Joe may be the guy in the audience.
Yeah.
And I might have had to do that a few different times to figure out what it was. Well, what do you want Joe to do? Well, can he bring a pizza over? Just a matter of going over it and trying it again. And something might flop that you say. And, well, okay, so if I said, okay, so what do you want? I want to talk to Joe. Why do you want to talk to Joe? I want to talk to Joe because I want him to spend the night tonight. You know, well, spend the night? What do you mean? So, I mean, it's just going over these things and finding what people think is funny. And it might take 10 times.
Right.
But when you're doing that, I think it's also important to have tried and true stuff. So when I try new stuff and polish it,
mm-hmm.
it's only maybe a portion of a character. So it's a long process.
You build it. You build up to where you have a new full routine by placing it in the middle of something that you know is going to work.
Exactly. Exactly. So the phone bit is Smolder already worked as a character. Mm-hmm. I've already polished that. And maybe his closing act already is polished. But now I want to do the phone thing. So now I may start with maybe 5 lines of the phone thing. And it may not be funny at all. No, nothing's funny about it, but it's just different. Now I go, okay, so out of those 5 lines, how am I going to start trying to make it funny?
Exactly. Right. Well, thank you so much for putting that out and saying that. We've never really talked about what polishing means. So that's so interesting. So interesting to hear how you create new things and actually insert them into your act. And you're working a lot. You work a lot. So how did that, you talk about, it's hard for, we had David Krohn on here many, many, many months ago. And he talked about switching over from having a job, a full-time paying job, to saying, I'm going to take the jump full-time. Since you were a stay-at-home mom, when did it really hit that you were working full time and that this was going to be your life?
Oh, gosh. I don't really know exactly when. I mean, because, of course, I had to be a mom, too.
Right.
So, but when I started doing birthday parties, you know, because that's where you start. You're not going to start at, you know, the big theaters. Because mm-hmm. you've got to polish your act. So, I mean, sometimes I would have, you know, a ton of birthday parties on the weekend. It's like, I can't even handle this.
Yeah.
Many, you know, go from one to another. It's just too difficult. As soon as, I don't know. I've been doing it now for 20 years. We do probably about 400 shows a year.
Wow.
And I know the math doesn't sound right, but we do several, we do fairs.
Yeah.
So we might do 3 shows a day.
It's got to be grueling. It's just, it's got to be, especially if it's hot.
It is, but it's fun.
Oh, I bet.
Because you get to just play with people and polish new material. The newest thing that we've done is the drone, and that was always something I've always loved. What I love to do is I'm kind of into right now doing, not using puppets at all, using just their voices. Just the idea of, do you watch The Big Bang?
Yes.
I love the idea that you never see Howard's mom.
Yeah, I love that.
I love that we know what she looks like in our minds, and we get it.
Yes.
And so I try and do a lot of that. I mean, the phone is something that, you know, is a bit in itself. But now the drone is an invasion that is coming and taking us over. And you never see the character. You see the drone, and you see the lights that flash back and forth with his voice,
mm-hmm.
you know, with the syllables of the words.
Yeah.
But you have to picture this character. And it's cool. It's a lot of... when you're doing a lot of shows, you can play around with stuff like that.
Yeah, it's really a lot of fun. And you get to set up shop in a location for a couple of days and just play. So that's, I love that aspect of it. And that's why this summer I'm trying to do some fairs and stuff myself. I do campgrounds. But
campgrounds are fun. Those are great too.
Yeah. I want to talk about that drone. You wrote a blog about its creation. And for those of us who are friends of yours on Facebook, we kind of, over the last couple of years, we followed as you were working on the state-of-the-art technology needed to create that character. So can you talk a little bit about what went into Godfrey's development?
I loved Lost in Space, and I love, I love science fiction. So my husband was into helicopters and the big helicopters, the professional helicopters. And so I was thinking, gosh, and I had seen drones coming out, this small drones, and I thought, wouldn't that be so cool? Especially on our outdoor stage. We have an outdoor stage that if I was just doing the show and I'm going to the next character, okay, now it's time to see Portia. All of a sudden, this drone comes over the stage.
Yeah.
And then it starts to talk. And so it was an idea I had in my mind. So I asked my husband, I said, hey, do you think you could build a drone? And because we do the show together. We've been doing the show together for, I don't know, about 10 years. He was able to fly it, and I was able to make it talk.
Awesome.
So it was kind of another very cool and different aspect on ventriloquism.
That's just awesome. Yeah, and let's talk about working with your husband, because I think when you work with a show partner, it really, that is either unseen or seen as a gag, even though you make a gag out of it because you're the star or whatever, I think it adds another dimension entirely to the act. So does the audience ever know that your husband's there?
Oh, yeah, they do. because he might, sometimes at fairs, he's the announcer.
Yeah.
So he announces the show the whole time, and then he might come out and do the announcing and say, okay, you know, Sylvia Fletcher. So they do know he's there. And then they do know he flies the drone. After the drone comes in, you know, they have no idea that's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
They're just watching a production show, and they have no idea that's going to happen. But as soon as it comes out and I make it talk and we do the bit with him, I say, okay, we'll see you later, Godfrey. And then I'll say, my husband flies Godfrey.
That's awesome.
With me, with a key fob, they see something in my hand. And what I have in my hand is like the mouth.
Oh,
it's
cool.
It's the key fob that allows the lights to go on and off so it looks like he's talking. But I don't fly it, and I don't want them to think I fly it because I don't. I mean, I can't. That's impossible.
Yeah.
So they know that he flies it. And then he does come in over the show because, you know, the show is, he's all part of the show. But plus the other cool thing is he's in my ear.
Yeah.
I have my monitor on so I can hear him in my ear. So if something, you know, if we're like going over time or something's like, okay, instead of doing this character, just do this character and we're done. So,
I love that.
It is. It's very cool.
I love how immersed your show is in the new technologies that really can be utilized by everybody, and how you're at the forefront of using technology to tighten up the show and make it really a state-of-the-art experience for your audiences.
The thing about when I got back into being to doing ventriloquism, and the thing that was really holding me back was I didn't want to have the basic vent figure. Now, this is just me.
Yeah.
I didn't want it to be old style. When Jeff Dunham came out and I saw him for the first time with his characters, and they were so modern and so, you know, peanut where he's standing and he's modern and he's a puppet and he's soft and he, you know, it, to me, that was great. I wanted to say, okay, great, I like it on a different level. I love ventriloquism on a different level. That's why sometimes I like the phone and different things. That's just, I'm into more modern type of stuff.
Yes, and this, I think, ties in. It's something I get weird, and sometimes I add questions that I don't know if anybody else cares about. But I think this ties into what you're saying about keeping it modern is you are the only ventriloquist I'm aware of that has a stage trailer.
Yeah. I don't know if I'm the only one, but I know that it is so cool to have our own stage and be able to make that work. And that's the way the drone can work, because it can come over and we can take fog machines on the top and put it on the top of the trailer where all of a sudden it starts smoking and the drone comes through the smoke. I mean, I want when people to see our show to see a production show that me and my husband put on that is like current.
Mm-hmm.
It's current.
Really fits into what's going on today. And
fresh, current and fresh and Universal Studios. I mean, obviously we don't have that budget.
Right.
but what we can do that is, you know, that is us.
That's really cool. Yeah, and I think I wish more entertainers in general thought like that. But the thing I wanted to ask you about it is, when did you decide, okay, that's adding an entire stage is the next step to creating that experience?
Well, you know, because we're limited when we're on other people's stages.
Yeah.
You know, say with the drone. Now, we've had the stage a lot. We've had it for maybe how many years? Maybe 8 years we've had our stage. But the freedom that you have having your own stage, plus putting it anywhere that you want. Someone might have a stage, like one of the fairs that we did, they had their stages next to tractors that were loud.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like, well, you know, we can create our own stage, drop it here, and we have them bring in the bleachers, And we've got our own setup, and we can have it where it's quiet. And we can, I mean, obviously you can't just put it wherever you want to. But you can, you really have a lot more freedom.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, some of the fairs that we didn't have stages that were, maybe the seats were too far back and not so close. It's just, we can create our own dynamic with our stage. If it's too hot, we can bring out the umbrellas, which we have these huge umbrellas that we bring out, and we can shade our stage, and we can decide where we want our audience. Instead of our audience spreading out in, like, one corner here, one corner here, one, if you don't have a lot of people, we take umbrellas, and people naturally sit under them. So they're right in the middle of where we want them.
Mm-hmm. You know, there's probably people going, well, what are you talking about? Staging and audience management, but just as important as talking about character development and creating new things, because it goes to creating an entire experience and an enjoyable experience, not only for the audience, but for the performer and as a group, just as a unit, having that moment together.
Right.
So I want to switch gears entirely now and talk about your books.
Okay.
You wrote a children's book. Tell us a little bit about that.
That was a whole lot of fun because it's called Sylvia or Sylvia and the Magic Trunk. And it's basically a story of how a little girl decided she wanted to become a ventriloquist. It's my story.
I love it.
And it's my character. So Chico, my possum, is the first character she brings out. And it just tells about how a little girl decided that she wanted to do this. And she started with a cup and making other things talk. And it's great. Then the second book is coming out, and it's got Smolder in it, the Stega Dragon, who is the second character in the book. But when we do school shows, they love authors.
Yeah.
So this way, not only is it just an author talking about the book, we act the story.
That's cool. That's really cool.
Which is great because, you know, we send the books before the show.
Mm.
They read about, say, Chico and what they're going to see, and then they're prepared to watch this. And it's very cool. One of the schools that we went into, we'd walked into it, and the kids are going, Chico, Chico, Chico. And I'm wondering, wow, how do they know Chico? Oh, duh. I gave them the book.
Oh, that's a really, really cool way of getting yourself in front of them and excited about seeing you, but also excited about reading, which I think we need a lot more of with kids today. I think that's a really cool tie-in.
It really is. I think the one that we do a lot is Get Lost in a Book. And, so reading is a big program. We do a lot of school shows, too. And so, yeah, that's it is really important to read.
It's awesome. And the other project that you're working on in terms of books is your own memoir.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit what you can. I know that's just in the writing stages, but tell us what you can about that.
It's an autobiography of an American female ventriloquist, and it's the story how a ventriloquist can begin.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think a lot of people don't know about ventriloquism, and they think it's just about not moving your lips, but it's not. It's about developing characters and how a lot of the things in your life are part of these characters. So when I was growing up, we had housekeepers and maids that worked for my parents. And through that experience as a little girl of growing up and with the maids and the housekeepers, I came up with Chico.
Oh, that's cool.
And so it's all throughout the book, you'll read how different characters were created and the ideology behind them. Because you can't, you know, based on if someone wrote you a script, it's not going to be as funny as if you live it. Mm-hmm. And it's something that was inside of you. Right?
Exactly. I'm just musing on that. Yeah, that's exactly. Pull from your own experiences.
And that's where it's kind of, it's, and that's how I'm writing it, is it all, you know, even Portia, one of my characters, Portia, is my cousin that I grew up with.
Oh, that's cool.
And, you know, the ideology for her, you know, the things that she does. And I'm able to create those because I lived it.
That's awesome. That's really, really cool. And that's a perfect kind of lead into what my last question for all of our guests are, which is, what do you want to see from ventriloquists coming up and this generation that's coming in and wants to do it? What does the art need?
Oh, I just, you know what? I told you I love contemporary. I love new. I love fresh. I love, you know, so anything new and fresh to me is exciting.
Yeah.
And just seeing people put their own personality and their being into characters is interesting to me.
That's wonderful, and that is a perfect place to end it. Miss Sylvia Fletcher, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you, Matt. This was fun. I hope I didn't, like, talk too much.
No. I like to go right at about 30 minutes, and that's where we are. So thank you so much, Sylvia. I wish you nothing but the best. TheMagicTrunk.com, everybody. And I can't wait to read your memoir, and I hope those that are interested, go ahead and check out that the Sylvia and the Magic Trunk book, and hopefully she'll be at a fair near you real soon. Thank you so much, Sylvia.
Awesome. Thank you, Matt.
Thank you again to Sylvia. Awesome talking to you, and I can't wait to see what comes of your projects. It looks so cool. That's it for us this week. Next week, figure builder and ventriloquist Steve Kilgore joins us, and let's just say I get to indulge in another one of the things I absolutely love to talk about and never get a chance to on this program. We haven't yet, so next week's going to be very, very special. Stay tuned. A reminder, you can find all you need to know about Ventriloquism Weekly by visiting our website, ventriloquismweekly.com. Reach out by emailing ventriloquismweekly@gmail.com and like our page on Facebook at facebook.com/talk42. Tweet at us and about us using #talk42. TalkForTwo. From New York, signing off for Ventriloquism Weekly, I'm Matt Bailey, reminding all you vents out there to keep talking 4-2.